Welcome to Taking Care of Business on Kern Radio News Talk 1180 for the very best in Saturday Talk Radio at 1 o'clock. And again on 1230 KGEO at 10 o'clock on Saturday. And for the best in Wednesday Talk Radio on 1410 KERI, Wednesday at 1 o'clock. And now, Clay, we are in Albuquerque, New Mexico on 1000 KKIM.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, all four stations. We're syndicated.
We're just moving ahead here, aren't we?
Yeah. 6 months ago, I couldn't spell syndication. Now we are syndicated.
I still can't spell it. So.
Your host is Clay Kerner, and I'm Marty Pay. And behind the big board is the man, the producer's producer, Greg Held. Hey, Clay, that was a great show last week with Wes Halula talking about human trafficking.
It was a very sad show when you
yes.
think about it.
Yes.
But he's making a movie that's going to be really interesting. And as I mentioned to you, either off the air, I believe, I was over on the coast last week and I saw a movie called Not Today. Mm-hmm. It's about human trafficking in India. And it's really interesting because what these parents do is they sell their kids because they can't give them food or education.
Right.
And people come along and tell them, well, we'll take the child and we'll give it a good education. We'll give it food. We'll train it. We'll give it an occupation. And what they do is they take the kids and put them into either some kind of slavery or in a production program in a mill or a mine or wherever. Or if they're really attractive, they'll put them into prostitution.
Right, which prostitution, pornography go along with the human
right.
trafficking. One of the numbers that he gave us last week that was frightening, he said once a kid gets into that, 7 years is their life expectancy.
Wow.
Yeah, and I think, in the research I was looking up for the program last week, they mentioned that it is the second most prosperous business in the entire world.
Billions.
Yes, billions of dollars.
And then the drug trade, of course.
Yeah, that goes along with it. Yeah. In the first half, we had Noni Darwish, who you and I saw last Monday night at the MOA event, and she was a little frightening. I mean, her message was just, you know, about
the
Islam.
Infiltration of Al-Qaeda
Islam. Yeah, in the United States. And mm-hmm. people have to keep in mind, it is not a religion. It is a political system.
It's a small portion of the Muslim population, but it's a very dangerous and
yes.
very scary population.
Yes. Today we've got a very special
Well, before
guest.
You go there, you know, okay. she also talked about the relationship of President Morsi with President Obama, and there's something going on there that we'd like to get to the bottom of, which goes back to Benghazi.
Well, and you know, it's going to be interesting. We're going to have John Bolton on next week talking about Benghazi, so it'll be interesting to see what his perspective is. But that was a little frightening when she talked about Benghazi.
Because yeah, it was.
There's more there than meets the eye. Now can I introduce our guest?
Who's our guest today, Marty?
Today, for the entire hour, all 42 minutes of it. We have a very, very special guest, author of 5 books and the president of Eagle Forum, Orlene Kurla. Orlene, welcome to Taking Care of Business.
Thank you very much, Marty and Clay. And we probably need to let them know it's president of Eagle Forum of California because Phyllis Schlafly is still alive and well and president for the whole nation.
And Phyllis has been around, well, as you and I have talked before, I was involved with the Eagle Forum about 20 years ago. The president at that time did a foreword in a book that I wrote. But Phyllis has been, she was the founder. She's been president of the national organization for 30 years, something like that? Or
it's more like 45.
45?
It goes way
wow.
back to the early 1970s.
Wow. Well, tell us a little bit about Eagle Forum before we talk about your books and your speech here in Bakersfield.
Well, Eagle Forum got its start fighting the Equal Rights Amendment. That's where Phyllis Schlafly also got her fame. There were only 3 states that they needed to ratify the Equal Rights Amendment, and then it would have been part of our Constitution, and boy, would that have made a lot of changes way back in the 1970s.
Amen.
But they could not get those last 3 states because of Phyllis Schlafly going around and speaking at all of the state hearings, and 5 of the states who had already ratified it rescinded their ratification once they heard her speak. And so then, once this was declared null and void by the Supreme Court, Phyllis Schlafly changed the name Stop ERA to Eagle Forum because she loves how the eagle flies into the face of the wind and the wind raises it even higher. And she's been doing that herself her entire life, facing the wind, and just somehow uses that opposition to come out smiling and shining and still brilliant. She'll be 89 in August.
Wow.
And she has just completed her 20th book, all about Obama and his attack on religious liberty, called No Higher Power. And she still has her syndicated column every Monday, a radio show every Saturday, and her Phyllis Schlafly report comes out once a month, as well as the Education Reporter.
You know, Orly, we may have to talk to you about getting Phyllis on. It'd be great to have her on the show.
I'm sure she'd be delighted to do that.
Good.
Orlene, you know, Obama's not attacking religion. He's only attacking Christianity.
That's true.
Ah, okay. Good point.
And she does bring that out in her book and gives many examples of how he's attacking Christianity.
We are having a conversation with Orlene Curla, the president of Eagle Forum of California, and also the founder and director, which we're going to talk about in a minute, of Californians United Against Common Core. Now, before we go to Common Core, one other question about Eagle Forum, just to explain to our listeners. I know at one time, next to Concerned Women of America, Eagle Forum was the largest conservative women's group in the country. Is it still pretty big?
It is still pretty big, but it has always included men. In fact, here in California, we have several men who are part of our state board, and Phyllis does nationally as well. But I think it's been growing because of all the strange things that are going on these days under Obama.
Yeah. Tell us about your books.
Well, the first book I wrote was back when I was living in Lincoln, Nebraska. It's called Looking at Lincoln, and it's just a history and tour guide of Lincoln and the humorous history that it had. Then I wrote one trying to bring some sense of morality back into the public schools. It's called The Golden Rule School. And my third book was about the smart meters. Oh, no, it was about, it's by Stealth and Deception, which is about 100-year history of the United States behind the scenes by Stealth and Deception. And I compare it to what was going on in the European Union. I tell about my husband growing up there and how they never spoke about having a European Union, just a European community. Nobody even knew they were forming a union until it was a done deal. And I think the United States is kind of slowly being moved that same direction and just one more step towards leading us to a big one-world government. And then my fourth book was about smart meters. I call it Just Say No to Big Brother Smart Meter. It tells about the three-year battle we had here in California to finally get an opt-out of the smart meters. And I link it to this, really, I have a whole chapter on how the total control of energy is part of the United Nations Agenda 21 goals, and definitely smart meters is part of that. And then my fifth book is all about Common Core and this strange new program for controlling our schools.
You know, before we move on to the Common Core, I just wanted to make a comment or an observation about the smart meters. When you put solar on your house, you really don't have an option. You have to go with what they offer you to manage the solar power.
That's true.
It's unfortunate.
And that's why my husband doesn't want solar. So we've been fighting to stay free of smart meters and solar for some time, and they told us when they first came to put the smart meter on our home, and we said no. They said, well, you'll just have to go off the grid. But that was 3 years ago, and we're still on the grid. So they use a lot of fear tactics to try to get you to go along with what they want you to do.
Yeah, you're right there. Two questions, basically. Number one, can you explain what Common Core is? And number two, why are Christians so against Common Core?
Well, Common Core is pretending to be a innocent state standards initiative, and in fact that's what they call it. It's a Common Core state standards initiative, but it is not. It is a top-down federal socialist program that is being imposed upon the 46 states that signed on to it, and they're trying to say that the governors signed on voluntarily, but they didn't. They were coerced to do so with a bribe, a waiver, and a threat. And in my book, I explain in detail just how that all happened. And why are Christians so opposed to it? Because they're finding out more and more just what some of the curriculum is going to be about and the standards and how it is going to definitely have an effect on taking away the freedoms of parents to have control over their own children's education, as well as the teachers to be able to even to have freedom to teach how they have taught in the past and what really works best in their classroom. So it's, I think, probably the more Christians find out about it, they're mainly opposed to the fact that maybe their religious freedom will also be taken, but definitely their parental rights, something we've always believed in.
Now, you're going to be speaking here in Bakersfield in June. When we come back from the break, I want to give that information out. But I'll also like to start out talking a little more about Common Core, because I know since you and I have talked about it, I was looking up some of the information, and it seems so benign. It's difficult to see on the surface where there's any problem with it. You really have to start investigating it before you really, really see how sinister this thing really is.
That's true, and they have done an amazing job keeping it hidden. That's why one of my points is this is kind of education by stealth and deception, because
sure.
For 3 years they have kept it so hidden. The governor signed on in 2010, and it isn't until 2013 we're actually finally finding out about it. And that was by design. They're hoping to make it so entrenched in the schools by this time that no one can get out of it, and parents won't really have any power to try to stop it.
Okay. Same thing with healthcare.
Sure.
That's right.
We'll be back in a moment on Taking Care of Business on Kern Radio News Talk 1180.